This screencast is going to focus on Summer 14 Question 2. In particular, we're going to focus on IAS 21, Translation of a Foreign Subsidiary. So this is DANCE PLC. So the first thing is to know, make sure to read the requirements of the question. In this case, you're asked for two requirements, consolidated SPLOCI, Statement of Profit and Loss and Other Comprehensive Income, and also consolidated SOFP. We'll also, just for completeness, we'll do a Statement of Changes in Equity as well as part of this question. So I assume you'll have read through the question, so if not, pause this screencast now, read through the full question. In particular, have some structured approach to how you read through questions. So in my solution, I will go through some key steps, particular step one and step two, I assume you've already gone through. So read the requirements and also briefly read down through all the notes, understanding what the group structure is, key dates, etc. So I'm assuming you've done that already, and we're going to get straight into the first step under IAS 21, which is translate the foreign op. So the foreign operation in this instance is our foreign sub, which is called ELV, which is in a burpees, should I say, currency. So just to go up in terms of the question that we've here, so we've three now. We've DANCE as the parent, ELV is the subsidiary, and FEDRA is another question, which is, in this case, if you've read through the question, you should know that FEDRA will be a associate. So I typically tell students to just no harm to put in the group structure to get marks if there's any marks going for identifying the group structure. So the first thing I will write down is what is the group structure. And in this case here for DANCE, I have 100% of the shares owned, therefore it's a subsidiary. And particularly why I tell students to write it down is, you know it's a sub, but you know it's also its prior year acquisition. And that is NB current year, prior year split. So for anything, particularly for IAS 21, it's important here, you know it's a sub, but it's also acquired in the prior year. Therefore, that's going to be very important when we look at how to present the FX differences, what goes to the SPLOCI and what might go to the Statement of Changes in Equity. And you can see that from the question, 30th of June 2012, and the current year end here is December 2013. The only other thing I'll put in then is FEDRA. You're told in the question, again, I've assumed you've read through the question, so go back if you haven't. 30% shareholding on the 1st of July. So straight away, it's 30%. I'll say that's an associate. Therefore, mid-year acquisition, so again, key dates, and also equity method. Just so I show the examiner that I know exactly what the group structure is and what accounting treatment is required. So now that I've understand the group structure, the next one of the key steps is IAS 21 is translate the SOFP according to IAS 21 rules. So I have the rules here in terms of assets and liabilities at year end, share capital at the date of acquisition, and then I typically leave all retained earnings at the plug. So any other reserves can be at the date of acquisition, and any of the retained earnings then are just left as a plug, and I figure out what the plug is made up of then. So you will see this in a second, it becomes clear, but the first step always is, and I've noted up here, translate the SOFP to figure out what the cumulative FX differences are currently in the SOFP. So we use the appropriate rate here, so any assets and liabilities will be at the closing rate, and we know the closing rate here is 1.6. So 1.6 here. And put in 1.6 for all assets and liabilities. For ordinary share capital, it is the date of acquisition. So the historic rate you use for the ordinary share capital. This, the date of acquisition, was the 30th of June 2012. So that was 1.5. Likewise, we also note that the retained earnings at a fair value and a revaluation surplus of 800,000 at that date as well. So we know the retained earning or the revaluation surplus of ELV was there at the date of acquisition. So that's important because you're going to use a rate of 1.5, the historic rate. And then I always tell students, leave this as a plug figure, and it'll be clear then what we'll figure out what that plug figure is made up of as we work out the rest of it. But the first one is to translate the statement of financial position of the foreign sub using the IAS 21 rules. So that's all we're doing here. We're using the relevant rates. And in that case now, the balance sheet obviously doesn't balance because we're translating at different rates, because that's what IAS 21 tells us to do. Therefore, we put in a plug figure here to say, this figure must be this. So the plug figure of what retained earnings translates into is 8.225 million. So we leave that. That plug figure is made up of a number of things we'll talk about in a second. But for now, the first step is we now have a euro balance sheet that we can use for our preparing our consolidated statement of financial position. Before now, we couldn't add these in because they're all different currency. But we now have euro amounts that we can use. So that is the first step that I suggest, is translate the SOFP. Now we need to do the workings in terms of calculate the cumulative FX differences. So remember, the plug figure now includes three things. It includes pre-acquisition retained earnings, i.e. retained earnings at the date of acquisition, which is 30th of June, translated at the historic rate, which in this case is 1.5. It also includes post-acquisition retained earnings, translated at the date where they were earned. So this post-acquisition retained earnings is at the date that should be they were earned. So that's whatever date they were earned, i.e. whatever year in they were earned, the average rate for that period is typically the rate that's done. Right? And the final one then, there will be a difference because you're translating the assets and liabilities and the income at different rates. So you'll have cumulative FX differences since acquisition. So that word there is important, cumulative, particularly when you have a prior year acquisition, as we do in this case. So the first step typically is then to figure out what these cumulative FX differences are. And this will be FX difference 1 and 2. So again, if this is new to you, you need to go back and revise IAS 21 consolidation issues, because this is the fundamental part of translating a foreign sub for consolidation purposes. So the two main sources of FX differences are translating income and expenses at a rate, transaction rate different than assets and liabilities, and translating opening net assets at an exchange rate that's different from the previous closing rate. Alright. So based on that, we'll calculate both of these now to figure out what those differences are. So if we come back here and we go down to working one, so we leave these, I've just this template set up for a second, we can come back to that at the very end. But working one, the first thing we want to look at is figure out what the cumulative FX differences are. So the cumulative FX differences are from 30th of June 2012 to 31st December 2013. So that's important there. We're looking at from the date of acquisition to the current reporting year end. And to get those, then we look at foreign exchange difference 1 and 2. So the way I label them is foreign exchange difference 1. Now I know I'm slightly labeled different up there, but difference 1 I always relate to is the net asset difference. So what was the net assets at the date of acquisition, converted at that date using the relevant rate, and then compare that to the date or the translation they would have been using the closing rate, FX rate. So the net assets at the date of acquisition would have been made up of ordinary share capital, would have been up of reval reserve, because we know it was there, and we're also made up of retained earnings. So you can get these from the question, and they are all B. So B thousands, or burpees as they're called in this. The ordinary share capital would have been 2.5 million. 800 was the reval surplus, we know that was there, and 8640 was the retained earnings, all at the date of acquisition. So the net assets at the date of acquisition would have been 11940. And if they were translated at the historic rate, so if we say at historic rate, which was 1.5, that would have got you, so I'll just open this out. If you translated the 11.9 million burpees at 1.5, you would have got 7960, and I'll just put euros here. So that's what they would be translated of, and that's what we have used so far in here, with some of them also have been in the plug. However, if they were translated at the closing rate, i.e. the rate at the reporting period end, which in this case is December 13, which is 1.6, they would have been worth 7463. Therefore, that gives you your first FX loss of minus 498. And again, I'll just put this in red just to have it more obvious. And that is fx difference 1. So I call it fx difference 1. So slightly, I reverse them where the steps are there, but I will change that for a solution. In that fx difference 1 to do with net assets is actually a loss. So by translating what we would have had in the financial statements, it would have been worth 7.9 million euros. But if you actually brought it at the closing rate, it would have been only worth 7.4. So that is one source of FX differences, 498. The next source, FX difference 2, is to do with income. So this difference arises because under IAS 21 rules, the income and expenses are translated at the average rate, whereas the assets and liabilities are translated at the closing rate. So there'll be an inherent FX difference there that you have to calculate as well. So because, remember, we've already flagged this as an important issue, we've already said prior year acquisition, we need to look at the differences across 2 years. So let's firstly look at profits for 2013. So profits for 2013 were, in the question, 2670. But you also have to take off 220 for a dividend. So watch out, that would have caught some students. You need to read down through the question and label this. There was a dividend paid at 220 during the period. Therefore, that has to be taken off when you're calculating your FX difference 1 and 2. So the first thing for 2013 was 2450. Again, under IAS 21 rules, it would have been done at the average rate. So the translation would have been at the average rate for 2013, which was 1.55. And everything else would have been done at the closing rate. So to compare the difference, the closing rate here we know is 1.6 as above. It's 1.55. So if we convert them just to see what the difference is, we see again there will be an FX loss. And just to be consistent, I'll copy these down. FX difference 2, and you have a loss of 49. So that means, again, because for only for 2013 now, we haven't looked at 2012 yet, the rule IAS 21 says is the average one, but everything else is at the closing rate. So to make those balance in the SOFP, we must have an FX difference of 49. We need to do the same working now, and I'll just copy it down for 2012 now, should I say. So 2012 is a bit more work because we have to work backwards to figure out what the profits are. So the profits for 2012 will be 13380, which again is the closing retained earnings for in the 13, minus 2670, which was the profits for 2013, plus 220 to add back the dividend. So we took off the dividend last year, we need to add it back because that was in profits the year before, minus 8640 to get post-acquisition earnings. So that was the earnings at the date of acquisition. So that gives us 2290 being the post-acquisition profits for 2012. And again, we need to get the separate years because the average rate for 2012 that would have been converted at is different than the average rate for 2013. So this would have been 1.5, meaning again we have a loss, an FX difference 2 of 95. So that means the cumulative FX difference would be minus 95, minus 49. So overall we have total cumulative FX losses. So cumulative FX diff 1 and 2 to be 145 plus 498. So cumulative FX losses of minus 642. And that is important. It's the first step that we look at because embedded in our plug figure of 8225, we know it's made up of three things. We know it's made up of pre-acquisition retained earnings, post-acquisition retained earnings, and the cumulative FX differences. So what we need to do now is, well, let's prove that's right, and let's figure what is the true retained earnings figure to take forward. So in this instance now, we go back and we see, well, what was the plug figure? Our plug figure, so let's bring it down, hopefully. So plug figure is 8225. And that's made up of pre-ac retained earnings at the historic rate. And it's always useful to just to confirm this because otherwise you'll end up getting confused and you want to make sure you have the right figures at the start. Then you have post-acquisition retained earnings at date earned. So we'll have two of them, so I'll just leave two figures. So let's bring this over one. We are going to have two different retained earnings, so I'll leave them two there. And then finally, you're going to have cumulative FX differences. Only one and two, so FX difference three, we will deal with separately. So one and two, and we'll put that in. So we'll just bring these over just to show from first principles. So the pre-acquisition retained earnings was 8640. And the historic rate that would have been translated at would have been 1.5. Right, so we know that already. So that would have given us here 8640 over 1.5, which is 5760. We also know in that plug figure is made up of post-acquisition retained earnings. So one is 2450, which is this one, at the rate it was earned, which is the 1.55. That's the IAS 21 rule. So 1.55. And the profits for 2012, which is 2290, that was earned at 1.5. So if we do the same for there, 2450 divided by 1.55, and likewise 2290 divided by 1.5. And bring in our cumulative FX differences. So we can just put that in red to be consistent. And hopefully if we add all those together, we can show that our plug figure is correct. So that's always the first step, is to figure out, that's what we figured out our plug figure to be, just by backing into it using that method. But we can also prove from first principles using FX difference 1, which is the net assets, and FX difference 2, which is the income. And we can show that adding those together and cumulating the last 642 gets us to 8225. So while I have up here, I may have shown FX difference 1 and 2 the other way around. It doesn't really make a difference, as long as you know within that plug figure you will have the net asset difference and the income difference. So that is the first key step. So one key adjustment that has to be made then is to, you know, under IAS 21, apologies, it keeps coming back. Under IAS 21, that should not be within the plug figure. So the cumulative FX differences under IAS 21 needs to be shown separately. So we'll credit retained earnings, 642, again credit to strip it out, and debit FX reserve, 642. So all we're doing there is stripping out the FX differences to be shown separately. And technically, these FX difference 1 and 2 should be attributable to the NCI, but in this instance, because Dance acquired 100% of ELV, there's no NCI, therefore it all goes to the FX reserve. So if we just come up here to Journal 1, so just Journal 1, 642, and I open up my own FX reserve, and I'll talk about this in a second, 642. So that's the key first step, is cumulative FX differences, strip it out of retained earnings, and put it into FX reserve and possibly the NCI, depending on if you only buy a proportion of the sub. So before we come back on now to the impact on the splocky, what I typically set up, and again you may have a different approach and that's entirely okay, is once you have the euro balance sheet, you can now set up your relevant T accounts. You'll know what the parent T accounts are, so I'll just put in 8225 there for retained earnings, because I know that is what the translated balance is for ELV. Likewise for revaluation reserve, I know it's going to be at 533, so I can fill that into my T account. So when I say down here in one of my steps, proceed as normal with consolidation approach, you have the same approach with your T accounts or columnar method as well, because you now have here all euro balances to use. Before we couldn't, because we had burpees in the currency. Now we have euros, so it's all okay. So likewise, we're not going to put in too much more other than, for example, ELV. We'll have ordinary share capital. And in this case, it's translated the historic rate, 1667. So I'll just put in that. So you don't need to open up all the T accounts initially. You can just open them up as you need them. But for now, it's useful to have some placeholder accounts. And we'll calculate goodwill in a second. And we'll see how we use the T account. All right. So that's typically how I set up the structure. Very similar to normal questions. The only difference is at the start, I need to translate my SOFP, and I also need to do some FX differences calculations to strip out the FX difference to its own. Now, one point I noted before was that this question is important, is that it's a prior year acquisition. Because if you have a prior year acquisition, if we go up to the rules of IAS 21, you will only have in your Splocky, you will only have the current year FX differences. So we've currently only calculated the cumulative FX differences. So that will be for the current year and prior year. So one thing you have to do when you have a prior year acquisition is you need to do these workings again. So the cumulative FX difference 1 and FX difference 2 for the current year as well, to figure out what the current year balance is. So we're just going to do that now just to prove what is the current year. Now, the quick people among us will realize there's actually going to be, it's going to be the exact same answer, because from the date of acquisition to the start of the current period was the same FX rate. So there will actually be no prior year differences, but again, it's useful for now for practice to work them out. So if we start here, current year, so it's a slightly different approach that we're now looking at what is the net assets at start of current year. So you have to look at a slightly different difference. So you're still going to have 2500 ordinary share capital. The reval reserve is still going to be at 800. However, the retained earnings now is not going to be 8640. It's going to be 13380 minus the profit for the year, which is 2670. And again, add on your dividends, which happen to be paid out during the period. So now, actually, our opening net assets was at 14230. And what we're comparing now is not to translate at the historic rate, we're translating at opening rate. And the opening rate happens to be the same here, 1.5. Because again, we know it hasn't changed from the historic rate to the opening rate. We are looking at the rate at the start of the current year, because we want current year differences. So we compare the start of the current year to the closing rate at the end of the current year, which is 1.6. So 14230 over 1.5 and 14230 over 1.6. So the difference there is an FX loss of 593. So we now know there's an FX loss, so that's FX difference 1. And we've calculated it to be a loss of 593. We're comparing what the opening net assets was at the start of the year to what it would have been at the closing rate at the end of the year. The same approach, but we're using slightly different figures because we're looking for the current year FX differences. Same approach for FX in our difference 2. We're now only worried about 2013. So we're only worried about the profits for 2013 because 2012 is the prior year. So it's the same, 2450, and it actually happens to be the same calculation. So we can take all of these across because the profit for the year, the average, same average rate you're using and the same closing rate. We were not interested in the prior year because that will give us the prior year FX difference. We're interested now in the current year. And if we add them cumulative FX differences up, similar to before, so we add 49 plus 593, so the cumulative differences gets us to 642, and lo and behold, it does equal what we said before. So the current year FX difference, although it's slightly shown differently between the split of 1 and 2, is the exact same as the current year, and we know that should be the case because the FX rate only moved this year. It didn't move between the date of acquisition and the start of the current period. Now, while I won't go through it, I'll show you the solution that you can actually work backwards. So hopefully I can bring this up to show you. So I've just done this in the solution. I've shown you the cumulative FX differences gets you to 642, as we've done. The current year differences gets us to 642. And just to show you here, again, you can stop it and look at what the calculations are. If we're doing the prior year, so comparing the 1st of January 2013 to the 30th of June 2012, you can look at it here. Right, so we compare FX difference 1, there's no difference. And the post-acquisition profits for 2012, which is the 2290, there's no difference. Because what we're comparing is 1.5 to 1.5. So all the FX differences will show up in the OCI. But again, that is important because that just happens to be nicely falling in this question. It may not in other questions. So in this case, I put a star here then to signify that that all goes to the OCI, and in B, it's a loss. So just because we've credited retained earnings, it's actually a loss. The only reason we're crediting retained earnings is that we're stripping out and to show it separately. So that is an important element that will come up in our OCI under IAS 21 and will also be shown separately in the statement of changes in equity. So once we have that done now, we'll go back up and look at our steps. The next step, step five, is proceed as normal. So we proceed as normal by setting up the T accounts in that regard and putting in the relevant balances. Now the one thing is, you will calculate the goodwill as normal as per step six. And it's important, use the historic rate to calculate the goodwill initially, which you will always do anyway, because this is how you've used the SOFP to bring in. So we've used the historic rate here to bring in the relevant items. So the first step is to calculate goodwill using the historic rate. So I'm going to show you T account, but I'll also show you how it comes up in Columnar as well. And once you have the goodwill calculated, we then need to retranslate it to come up with the final FX difference as per IAS 21. So the way I do my goodwill calculation is I take my investment in ELV and bring it to the cost of control. So I'll show you T account first, and then I'll show you how to do it in Columnar. So that's just investment, 8200. I then bring in and strip out the share of ordinary share capital, which in this case is the all of the ordinary share capital, which is the 1667. So again, I'm using the 2.5 million burpees at the historic rate of 1.5, and just bring this in as ordinary share capital, 1667. So again, what I'm doing here is I'm using the historic rate, and there's no NCI, so it's all going to the cost of control. I have to bring in, I'll bring in my reval reserve, just because I have it done easier here. And I'll strip that out, cost of control, 533 as well. So that's removed, and that will not be going to our consolidated statement of financial position because it was pre-acquisition reserves. The final one I need to do now is retained earnings. And be careful here, do not use 100% of this, because this includes post-acquisition retained earnings. What we need to do now is, it's 8640, which is retained earnings at the date of acquisition, over 1.5, which is the historic rate at that date. And again, we don't need to do any, should be equals. We don't need to take any proportion because we acquired 100% of the entity. So the goodwill initially will be 240,000 based on the historic rate. And that is what step 6 tells us here. Calculate goodwill initially at the historic spot rate. And then retranslate at the closing rate. That is FX difference 3. So FX difference 3 here. 1 and 2 we've done already. 3 is retranslate goodwill at the reporting date. That will not be in the plug figure because this is only coming from the consolidation workings. So if we go down here, that's working 1. Let's look at working 2 now, so just bring this down to see it. So working 2, we'll call it journal 2. So goodwill at historic rate equals 240. And for people who want to say, well, how would I calculate that if I was looking at Columnar method? Well, we can do it out here. It cost 8.2 million, so we'll call this in euros. It cost 8.2 million, and we're given that in the statement of financial position, 8.2 million euros. The net assets at acquisition, you had ordinary share capital, you'd retained earnings, and you had reval reserve. And this was in burpees. And again, we don't need to reinvent the wheel. We had this from before. Up here, we can see the opening was 2.5 million, 800,000, and 8640. So we have these already done. So 2.5 million, 8640 and 800, meaning the opening net assets in the foreign currency, burpees, was 11940, and translate that at the spot rate at that date is 1.5. Now I'll just put that in as minus because I want to take it away, and you'll add them up, So you take the full because you've no NCI, giving you goodwill of 240. So you get to the same answer as you would using the T account method. You just have to do it a slightly different way. And again, no NCI, therefore full goodwill goes 240 at the historic rate. However, under IAS 21, you have a rule that goodwill must be retranslated at the closing rate every time, and any movement is treated as an FX difference. So in this case, the closing goodwill must be using the closing rate. So it's 240 times 1.5 over 1.6. So the 240 is using the initial rate of 1.5, so bring it back into burpees. So times 1.5 to get it back into burpees, and retranslate it back at the closing rate, which is 1.6. So it's 225. So you have there, you have an FX loss. I'll just get consistent. Loss in B cumulative. So that is the FX difference 3. Goodwill, if you retranslate it at the closing rate, will be reduced by 15. So to do the debits and credits there, it will be debit, FX reserve, credit goodwill. And that's what IAS 21 says to do, is you have to retranslate goodwill at every period. So it will be debit, FX reserve 15, credit goodwill 15. That's FX difference 3. And note, and I have to put the note up here as well, if you can see it, the FX difference to the NCI for FX difference 3 should only be done if method 2 is used. We have no NCI here, therefore it all goes to the group, and therefore it all shows up in the FX reserve account. Also note that if a sub is acquired in the prior period, which we have, you need to allocate the current year differences to blocky. So similarly to what we've done here, in terms of what is the current year FX difference 1 and 2, we also need to figure out what the current year FX difference 3 is to show in the splocky. Because this is the cumulative since the date of acquisition. So we now have to figure out, and again, we already know there will be no prior year difference because the FX rate hasn't moved. But just to show how to do it, so you have the goodwill at the 1st of the 1st 2013, if it was retranslated, would have been 240 times 1.5 over, what is the rate at the end of 2012? It is also 1.5. So 1.5. Therefore, there's no prior year FX diff. Therefore, all of this FX loss is current year. Therefore, we'll just put here OCI NB loss. So you need to split out between current and prior year, because prior year will go to the statement of changes in equity. The current year has to be shown in the OCI. But similar logic to before, because the rate has only moved in the current year, there will only ever be current year losses. So this was a nice question. It was fairly straightforward, and it also had no NCI. So let's put in those debits and credits. Credit goodwill, 15. So bring in cost of control. Goodwill is 240. And journal 2, then credit goodwill, 15. And then also showing the FX reserve, journal 2, 15. So we'll have a separate column, 657, which is FX losses in this instance. So that is our initial workings done for the FX. We've all done for the FX part. We now have to go through the question, see is there any more elements we need to do in terms of any adjustments we need to make. So we're now on working 3. So we come down here. Apologies. So we go to 3. So we will go through the question. The next adjustment we need to make for is the intergroup dividend. So ALV paid a dividend during the year of 220. So we should take this case. We're told what the rate at the dividend was 1.55. So we'll use that, and it happens again to be the same as the average. So intra group dividend. So if ELV paid a dividend of 220, remember we've no NCI, so we own the portion. So dividend would have been 220 over 1.55. So I just need to put in equals. Is 142. So because it's paid, you don't really have to make an adjustment to the SOFP, because it would have been just debit retained earnings, credit retained earnings. What we need to do is splocky remove from other income. Because within other income, up here, Dance 220, now just so happens they have 220 recognized as euros. That is not a mistype, it's just perhaps confusing for students. You only need to remove the intergroup element, which is 142,000 euros. So we will have an adjustment in our Splocky to remove intergroup dividend of 142. Alright, it's just confusing that there happened to be 220 in the statement of financial position or statement of profit and loss other comprehensive income. So that is that adjustment. Working down through it then, what else are we told? We're also told the goodwill arising in the acquisition was impaired by 50,000 burpees. So this hasn't been made, and again, the simple thing is to adjust at the average rate. So you put the adjustment in at the average rate, it doesn't impact anything else. So it'll be credit goodwill, 50,000 over 1.55. Keep forgetting to put the int equals. And then debit will be retained earnings, 32 as well. And don't forget to put here, this will be in the Splocky, because it is obviously a full item, there's nothing to do with NCI, and it is impairment for the current year. Because you're told, where am I here, during 2013, which is current year. So you're always, for the impairment of goodwill, use the average rate if it's the current year, or the average rate for the prior year if the impairment took place in a prior year. So now we're on to part 5. And in this instance, we're told the trade receivables of Dance includes 920,000 receivable from Fedra in respect of sales made since the 1st of July. So these are sales from the parent to an associate. So from parent to associate. So that's important depending on what the adjustment is required. So now we're not dealing with any FX issues, it's just parent to sub. Total sales made since the 1st of July were 1350, and Dance supplies goods to Fedra at a price to achieve a gross margin of 20%. So remember, the first thing is there unrealized profit? And because it's an associate, we don't remove any intergroup sales or intergroup balances, because associate is not a group company. Associate is only 30%, so it's only accounted for as an equity method. So do not remove any intergroup balances. So we'll say revenue, in this case, was 1350. We know profits were told to be making 20%, so profits must have been 270. Therefore, we can back into what costs were. Okay, we don't really need it here, but costs must have been 1080. So the profits for the year were 270. The unrealized profits, i.e. how much is left in inventory at year end, is the first step. Unrealized must have been, in this case, 25% of the goods were still in inventory at year end. So we take 25% of that. So we'll say 25%. And watch out here, because it's equity method, you only take investor share. If it was a sub, you take the full amount of the unrealized profit. But in this case, we only take 30%. Because it's only the investor's share. So because it's from the parent to the associate, we now debit retained earnings, because it's the parent, or the profit is sitting in the parent's accounts. So debit retained earnings 20, credit investment in associate 20. And again, that was going to have a Splocky impact, because the profit has to be removed from the parent because they made the sale. So journal 4, we should have done this, journal 4 and journal 5, but I forgot to do journal 4. So journal 4, credit 32, goodwill. And journal 4 here, 32. And I'll also do journal 5, 20. And journal 5, investment in associate, 32. Or should I say 20? Now I'll just bring in, the investment in Fedra is obviously in the balance sheet, 4.3, and you can then reclassify that as investment in associate, 4300. So you don't really need to do that, I'm just showing you where they come from, investment, and 4300, just to open up and to see that that's an investment associate line item for the consolidated statement of financial position. So we're working our way down through. We've done our intergroup balances. And remember here, you do not remove the intergroup sales or the intergroup trade receivable because the associate is not a group company. The final thing that students forget to do then is you need to allocate a share of profits not to the NCI, because we don't have an NCI here, but to the associate. So that is always one key step in terms of finishing off the consolidated accounts, is share of profit to NCI, if you have it, or share of profit for the associate. So in this case, remember, and we've already flagged it, and that's why I tell students it's useful for as a reminder, this is a mid-year acquisition. You acquired Fedra the 30% halfway during the year. So you'll only have half the profits. So the share of profits you will get is, in this case it's losses, minus 96 times a half times 30%. So you only get a 30% share. So it will be minus 96 times 0.5, or 6 over 12, times 0.3. So it's a loss of 14. And again, just to be consistent, we'll put that and take off the border. So it will be here, debit retained earnings, because it's a loss, 14. And we will credit investment in associate. And again, that is the equity method under IAS 28. And don't forget, that will go in this blocky as an associate line item, loss of share from a share of loss from associate. So I call it profit here, but it actually is a loss. So journal 6, debit retained earnings 14, and credit investment associate, journal 6, 14. So again, that's a step you shouldn't forget to make, because you know you're going to have an associate, therefore you know you need to go to give them some proportion in the statement of our SPLOCI, statement of profit and loss and other comprehensive income. So that's all the steps we need. We've now have all our T accounts, or if you use Columnar, you have all your adjustments aggregated together that we need to finish off now and populate the statement of financial position. Now I'm just noticing here I have one small error that I never put my cost of control element, the 5760, into my retained earnings. So that should be COC. So again, you should have that at the start, and I'm just recognizing it now. But we now have our T accounts done. We've all the adjustments taken care of. We've a share of profits given to the associate. So all we need to do now is we come back under our step 7. Prepare the consolidated statement, or consolidated financial statements, should I say, apologies, as normal. First step is always the SOFP. So just take the balances from the T accounts if you have them, and if it's not from the T account, all you're really doing then is taking the SOFP balances. We didn't have a T account for property, plant, and equipment, so we just take the, should I say, dances balance, which in this case is 20830. So 20830, and add in the euro amount. So don't make the mistake of adding in the burpees, add in the euro amount 8288. And that should get us to 29188. And just for the examiner, I might put SOFP balances here so they know where I'm getting the figure from. I'm only adding up the balances together. Goodwill, I will have a T account. So I come down here and I see my goodwill is 193240 initially, taking account of FX loss and impairment. Finally, investment associate. I also have a T account, or you might do the Columnar method, but all you're doing is the initial cost, adding on or taking away the share of losses, and also the intergroup trading adjustment for the period. So that's our initial balances. Inventory, trade receivables, and cash. I didn't have any balances. They're all coming from the SOFP. I did no adjustments, should I say. They're all coming from the SOFP balances. So 4220. Plus the translated euro amount, which is 1463. Trade receivables is 6530. Plus, in this instance, 2175. And then cash is 860. Plus the translated amount of cash here, 213. So I might just, again, for the examiner, note that these are all coming from SOFP balances as opposed from a T account working. But again, once you have the T account and the initial adjustments done, it makes the population of the financial statements themselves relatively straightforward and a fairly quick enough process. So we now go and we fill in the equity and liability section of the statement of financial position. First thing is we look at ordinary share capital. So in this case here, we have the T account is 6 million. So it's obviously just the ordinary share capital of Dance. Share premium. Dance has share premium itself. So we didn't need to open up a T account. So it's just 1 million for the parent. So we put that here, 1 million. Retained earnings we can take from the T account. So you may do it in a column method, but 33421 is the correct answer regardless of which way you go about it. And again, unusual for consol, but this is an IAS 21 rule. You need to show the cumulative FX differences separately, and that will be an FX reserve under the equity section account. And we have it here, 657. And again, that is a debit balance, so it should come in as a minus in the equity section. So watch out for that. It is a debit balance, therefore all of these are credit balances. So the total equity, no NCI in this case, is 39,764. The long-term liabilities in terms of for non-current liabilities, again, there's no adjustment made in the question, therefore we just take the statement of financial position balances. So 2440, so plus 2440, plus, in this case, the long-term liabilities were for Dance, 138 when converted. So that gets us to 2578. And similarly for trade payables, the current proportion of long-term liabilities and tax, it's merely just the balance, which is 4550 here, 4550, plus trade payables for ELV, which is 1400. Similarly for the current portion, it is 140 plus the current portion down here is 31. And finally then tax will be 430 plus the tax down here, which is 144 when translated. And hopefully then we have balance, and if we don't, we have to go back and look. So we don't here, so I just want to double check. So again, we haven't added in, so just bring this across. The subtotal of long-term liabilities is 2578, and if we add them up, we get 49037 and 49037. And again, it's just good practice to put in these three balances are coming from just the balance that's provided in the question, as opposed to any adjustments. So it's clear to the examiner that they know, they don't have to go looking for any T account or working, that they know where you're pulling the figures from. So that's the first one, is the statement of financial position. In terms of preparing the splocky, which is the next one, remember you translate the foreign op at the average rate. So each of the balances for the foreign sub in this instance will be at the average rate, and the foreign exchange differences should be shown separately. So in the OCI, other comprehensive income. So we go up, first thing is always how many months should we have ELV? We have it for the full year, therefore it's 12 over 12. So when we're converting, we're going to take the splocky, which in this instance we have here with a profit of 2670, and we're going to use each line item. We're going to divide that by the average rate for the year, which in this case was 155. So for revenue, again, we're not going to just go, well, it might be easier to just have them both open at the same time. So for revenue, it will be plus 24150 over 1.55. Let's put an equal. This equals minus 16480 over 1.55. Other income they don't have. Distribution costs, you have minus 2240 over 1.55. You have minus 2380 over 1.55 for admin costs, and they have finance costs of 25 over 1.55. That gets you to profit before tax of 195 euro, and income tax is minus 355 over 1.55. Now, some students, I always tell students, again, you'll see from my other questions, leave this page at the start that you have a template set up. Some students like to fill it in as they go, others leave it till the end. But you'll know you may have line items here, so leave separate line items that if you do fill it in at the start, that you're not going to be trying to squeeze in things at the end, that you will have space to put in relevant line items. But what you're doing here is all converting them at the average rate during the period, which was in this case 1.55. Similar to questions before, go back to your workings and look for any adjustments that may need to be needed in the splocky. So if we go down to our workings and we look for, just open them up here, we look at our workings. So we leave the OCI adjustments till the end, until we come to that section. We have to remove 142 of other income and an extra expense for goodwill of 32. So remove minus 142. So put it over here. Minus 142, and that is to remove the intergroup dividend element. So there's obviously other dividends as well, but we're not interested in those. And we'll also put it in, you can put it wherever you like in terms of impairment. We'll put it into admin expenses, minus 32, for the goodwill impairment during the year. That's why the label is very useful. When you're coming to the preparing this blocky, a lot of it is already there. So another additional expense of 20, that is to remove intergroup unrealized profit. And also then a loss from the associate of 14. So we put on those, minus 20 for the unrealized profit, and then minus 14 for the profit from the associate. So totting them up and bringing them across, including Dance, the parent, 12 months for Elv, because we owned it, for the full year, at the average rate, plus any relevant adjustments, as we have labeled, using the ** label. You can use whatever label you want, just make sure you have some system in place that is fairly efficient for the day of the exam. That gets us to a normal statement of profit and loss of 6835. In this instance, we also have other comprehensive income. And here we have two things, foreign exchange difference 1 and 2 for the current year, which is minus 642. So only the current year goes into this blocky. Any prior year differences would go to the statement of changes in equity. But in this case, we only have current year differences because there was no prior year based on the movement in FX rates. And we also then have an additional 15 from FX difference 3. So that gives a total of minus 657. So you have minus 15 and you have minus 642. And if we add them up, you have total FX differences of minus 657, which again matches here. So you can link these two figures and we will do that in the statement of changes in equity. Now we have total comprehensive income of 6178 attributable to the parent. You probably don't need to do this in this question because there's no NCI, but just for comprehensiveness, all of the profit is towards the parent and all of the total comprehensive income is again towards the parent. So that's just showing you how to prepare a fully comprehensive consolidated statement of profit and loss or the comprehensive income when you have FX differences. And IAS 21 says to present them in OCI. So that is our splocky, and again, just as an add-on to this question, we're going to set up a consolidated statement of changes in equity. So it's not asked for, but it's useful to practice. You can always remember the first starting point for how many columns am I going to have in my statement of changes in equity. It's going to be the number of elements in your equity section of your SOFP. So you have only four elements here, therefore you're only going to have four columns. You typically would have an NCI column as well, but again, as we said before, there's no NCI here. The main movement you have here is total comprehensive income from the year. Starting point should always be, you know what the answer is to statement of changes in equity. The closing balance will always be the closing balances from the SOFP, so you can slot them in. So we already know what the balances are during the period. Let's bring that across. And what we're looking at then, we're trying to work back to the opening balance. And the only really movement during the year was the total comprehensive income for the year. So this had minus 657, and this comes from this blocky. So minus 657 goes to its separate account. And likewise, for retained earnings, it was the profit for the year, which was 6835. So if we work back, ordinary share capital must have been 6 billion at the start. Likewise, share premium. Opening retained earnings must have been 26586, and opening FX reserve must have been nil, because nil plus 657 gets us there. And it's always useful to sense check then, can you prove that the opening retained earnings was that figure? Can you prove that the opening FX reserve was that figure? And that will just make a good sense check of whether you're right or not. So to prove the opening retained earnings, you first look at the parent, which is Dance. What was its opening retained earnings on the 1st of 1st 2013? Well, its opening retained earnings would have been the closing retained earnings at the end of the year, 33.80, minus the profits met for the year, 5320. So 33.80 minus 5320 is 25060. So clearly that doesn't make it up. So we're either gone wrong or we're missing some element. And the key to remember here is that ELV was acquired, so you were looking for post-acquisition profits at 1st 13. Because it was acquired in the prior year, period, should I say, you should have some profits attributable to the group for those 6 months, i.e. the 6 months between the date of acquisition, which was the 30th of June 2012, and the 1st of January 2013. And how you would calculate that would be, what was the end of year? So 13380 was at the end of 2013. So start with that. Take off profits for the year, which was 2670. Add on the dividend that was paid out, because remember that would have been an adjusting factor. And then take off 8640, which was the opening retained earnings. So this would give us post-acquisition profits up to the start of this year. So in this case, we put an equals here, it's 2290, which again, you should have hopefully remembered that. You'll see it's the exact same as the figure we calculated here. 2290, the profits for 2012, i.e. ignoring current year profits, just the profits for the prior year. So based on that then is 2290, remember that is also in burpees, so we want to translate that at the average rate. So the average rate would have been for 2012, 1.5. So 1526. So put that in. So just round that down, 1527, and we add them up. We can see that's where it gets us to 2568. Now, there's a small bit of rounding here. We're not too worried about that. But that proves that we are right there. So if we take the opening parent retained earnings, add on our share, which is 100% here, because we own the full amount, the share capital, we get 26587, and that matches what we proved to be. What we're also looking for here is, what should have been the opening FX reserve? So this is essentially saying, from ELV, was there prior year FX differences? And we've already proved in terms of, and I'll just show you the prior year, in terms of prior differences, we showed this calculation already. There's no prior difference, just for illustration. All of it is a current year, because it hasn't moved from 1.5 until the start of the current period. And likewise, we also shown in our calculation for goodwill that all of the movement in goodwill was due to the current year, nothing for prior year. Therefore, this makes sense then that our opening balance in our FX reserve would have been nil. That no prior year FX diff. So that makes sense as well, that we have nothing at the start of the year. That may not always be the case, but again, in terms of preparing a consolidated statement of changes in equity, it's useful to work back towards that, that start here, closing balances, put in any movements, note dividends that we talked about here would not go in here, because that is dividends of intergroup to sub. The only dividends that go in here would be dividends to the NCI, which we don't have, or dividends of the parent, which we're not told about. Therefore, we can assume there are none. So the first part is closing balance, put in movements for the year, and then work back to the opening balance. And always it's a good sense check, can you prove what the opening retained earnings is, and does that match? Because if it doesn't, you may have gone wrong somewhere throughout the question. So that looks at question, summer 14, question 2, looking at Dance PLC, particularly at IAS 21, the retranslation of a foreign subsidiary. And again, just to go back and look at the suggested steps. Some of them are very similar to when you're preparing a normal consolidation question. Others have a bit of difference in terms of translation, and also preparing FX difference 1 and 2, and also FX difference 3 associated with goodwill.